What's up, Pound Nation, and happy 4th of July. This week, we're going to take a look at last week's Pounder's thesis pick, Unity. We're going to take a look at EVs, JOBY on the eVTOL space, Supreme Court case impacting SoFi, Overstock.com acquires Bed Bath & Beyond, huge short report on exponential fitness, and stick around, we have another Pounder's thesis pick, UiPath. Another episode of Pounding the Table begins in 3, 2, 1.
And so, my fellow Americans,
37 points or so. Apple shares are just getting hammered this morning.
We're down by what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country.
I wonder why fund managers can't beat the S&P 500.
Down by 4-5%.
And sheep gets large.
What in the world is happening on Wall Street?
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to episode 81 of Pounding the Table. I am back with Joey Salicho and our new co-host because he hit that Pounder's thesis pick last week. We're bringing him back. So, Shai, welcome back. How you guys doing on this Friday? I know we have some breaking news here, Joey, if you want to get into this Coliseum fight that's about to go down.
Yeah, so we just saw scroll on Twitter that the Italian government says that Mark Zuckerberg and Elon Musk can fight at the Coliseum. So, I mean, that would be pretty cool, kind of like a gladiator-style battle in the Coliseum, but I don't think Dana White's going to go for that. I think he's going to go with the typical UFC massive Vegas bout. I think all, like, the, you know, added economic activity to do that. Why hand that over to Italy?
I haven't taken a look at MGM pricing, but, like, could that play a role if they go fight there? Do you think MGM comes up on that?
I mean, I don't think it would be all that significant, but I mean, you never know.
Or the Coliseum go public there too.
I mean, I think it's going to set the new gambling record. It's going to beat the Super Bowl. The amount of like dollars going to be spent in Vegas.
Have you seen any odds that have come out yet?
Yep. The most recent odds I saw was Musk actually winning.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Kind of interesting because everyone's all up on Zuck for that.
Yeah, you would think because, you know, he's trained in Brazilian jiu-jitsu that he would be at least the favorite now, unless they think size is that significant of a difference. Plus, I saw Elon Musk was training with somebody doing jiu-jitsu. So.
Well, he's kind of like the Yankees or Green Bay Packers where they get the public. So if you're betting the Yankees, there's always some additional price in because how many Yankees fans there are that are going to be buying. So Elon's got all these people on Twitter.
I know Zuckerberg got some hatred back in like Cambridge Analytica days and everything, but seeing him hold his own in front of Congress that one time, that, you know, kind of like ice in the veins type guy.
There was a huge swing in the odds. Like last weekend, it was Musk winning. I just checked FanDuel, -440 for Zuck winning.
Wow. Okay. See, people probably finally checked into his background of training. Yeah. Like the dude, he's serious. Like he just won an actual jiu-jitsu competition, unless this fight is going to be like years away that Musk has, you know, time to train. But I don't think you can expedite that sort of training, you know, in months that Zuck's been doing probably for years now.
All right, let's get into the week, guys. So Pounder's thesis pick from last week, Unity. Again, this is never investment advice. We're just doing some research. But Shai, you came up with the Pounder's thesis pick of Unity. Up 19% on the week at the time of this recording. So it's about 1:30 Eastern. But Shai, there's some additional news.
Yeah, it was in the high 30s when we talked about it last week. But I mentioned that this is a very undervalued AI play. And there's going to be some news coming out in coming weeks that's going to make people have their eyes pop on the amazing tech that Unity has. And we were right. They announced this week the launch of a AI marketplace within its Unity asset store. Exactly what we talked about last week. It's going to accelerate all the gaming content to the 3D marketplace. And I can promise you this, in 5 years, the amount of gaming content is going to be out there is going to be massively increased from what it is right now. And I think that Unity's capitalizing on this right now. And it's a great time to be a shareholder in the stock. And I wouldn't be surprised if we see the stock over $50 in the coming weeks.
Joey, just say it. I see you go.
To answer your question, the proposed deal by AppLovin years back was $58.85 per share for Unity. So it is still significantly below that level.
Let's get into the market highlights of last week. So obviously today, the big headline was PCE price index moved down to 3.8, which is its lowest levels since April 2021. peak being 7% in June of 22.
It's still well above where they want it to be. I mean, it's good to see that, you know, it's not rising as significantly as before, but we're still a ways off from where we need to be. And I don't think this is enough to stop Jerome from what he's about to do with, where he said, you know, you could get consecutive rate hikes over the next two meetings. So we'll kind of see where he's going, but, you know, it seems like he's destined to make sure, or at least attempt to drive the market lower. And if not, you know, see how many have an issue with the rate hikes that are coming. Because, you know, the last couple set of rate hikes is when we saw the whole bank fiasco last time around. So now the question is, how many of these regional or small banks could fall if these rate hikes come into play and make things worse on them?
The market's still driven by the Fed. I mean, that's kind of been the theme, I'd say, over the past year and a half, really. Everyone's watching J-POW. So are we still in that type of market, would you say?
Well, so I still think like the don't fight the Fed saying is always going to be something, you know, that it's not a bad way to live. However, it seems like the market got crushed because of the Fed for the longest time. And it's still looking like one of those forward looking things where it seems like the market started to make its uptrend once they saw, you know, rate hikes are almost over. So it's interesting to see once more rate hikes are on the horizon that the market has still been so resilient. But yeah, we are caught in a weird situation where it feels like we've been in this nonstop uptrend. We haven't had any real significant pullbacks. And we were even talking before the show, could the market continue to rise slowly through the summer and even through the rest of the year? Or are we going to get that significant pullback? I feel like it would be healthy for the rally if we did see, you know, a 5-10% pullback just to calm down and then start climbing that staircase again. Mm-hmm. But I mean, we look at how the market's acting today and, you know, there's really no telling where it's going to go. So I feel like as investors, we're always just along for the ride. And that's kind of how I'm playing it right now. Just continuously reevaluating my positions, making sure I'm as best positioned to benefit from a continued uptrend, but I'm also protecting myself that if we have a significant pullback, that I'm not in some very high risk, high reward situation where it's going to tank, you know, twice of what the market move may be.
Taking a look at the jobless claims, right? They came in at 239, estimated at 266. So, you know, J-POW is looking at the jobs. People are still working and it's not as bad as people think. I know sometimes we say those numbers don't matter, but if that is an indicator for the Fed, like, what are your thoughts on that?
I mean, I think jobs is a little manipulated. A lot of companies use list job openings just even though they're not trying to hire. Yep. Just so they have that front of like they're succeeding and they're doing well, but they have no intention in actually filling those roles. Do not like the jobless claims as a good metric to justify like how our economy is doing. I think it's a pretty outdated metric. Mm-hmm. But having said that, I do mimic what Joey just mentioned. This past week, I did some trimming in my portfolio, raised the 5% cash position to have some kind of ammo entering the earnings season in the next couple months. It's been a while since we had this kind of run up into earnings season. Now, like the expectations are pretty high that if some companies exceed but don't excel into their earnings, they might get punished. Like we just saw that Micron, Nike suffered yesterday. I think that might be a trend for the next coming earnings season.
US May home sales come in at 763K, estimated at 675. 12.2 month on month increase. Joe, I know you were going to touch on that.
Yeah, I mean, home sales just keep trucking along. So it's interesting to see that with interest rates, and I think mortgage rates are now averaging over 7%, that that's not really slowing people down. Maybe there's some good incentives from these home builders for people buying these new homes, but I did find that number interesting that those are still so strong. And that could be a direct play on what you're saying, where we're still seeing strong employment numbers, not much wage growth, but yeah, I guess people are still willing to spend up to buy homes in this market.
I'm shocked to see how well the home builder stocks are like doing this year. Like if you told me that the Fed would raise 500 basis points of rate hikes and the home builders would be at the price they're at right now, I'd be like, you are delusional. But that's like where we're at right now. It's the home stocks are very strong right now.
Get into EVs real quick. Lordstown Motor is officially filing for bankruptcy. Ford's laying off 1,000 contractors and salaried workers. Lucid Motor, some positive news here. Recent deal with Aston Martin is just the beginning as it plans to license its technology to others as well. also received an investment from Aston Martin in order to gain access to this technology. And then finally, Polestar and Tesla. So this, we were just joking that we need to do a weekly update on where Tesla's going, because Polestar signed a deal with Tesla to gain access to their NACs, which we've been talking about the past few weeks. So they're really going to build this monopoly. He's going to become the new oil tycoon.
We talked about this when the original deal was struck between, I think, GM, and then we saw where it was Ford, and then it was GM. We kind of talked about this where everybody would either need to fall in line or start making these other partnerships. And I thought we would see both, but no, it seems like now everybody's just moving to these NACS chargers and making Teslas the absolute standard. So now you're seeing all the other charging station stocks kind of follow suit, adding those chargers to their network. But I still think Tesla's the superior brand where everybody's going to want to be charging at their supercharger. You know, it seems like Tesla's always been about doing it themselves. So I'd love to hear an update, not just about their cars, but update on what they're planning to do with their infrastructure.
So we just saw Lordstown go under and file for bankruptcy. I mean, this is not an inexpensive business to start to go. Again, Tesla's had 10-year runway on a lot of these. So do you think there's going to be a lot of mergers and acquisitions in place, or do you think they'll just let these guys die, acquihire for some of the talent on designers? Like, what do you think is happening there?
Well, we talked about this on a previous podcast where I thought there could be some potential for some of the bigger non-Tesla automakers to acquire some of these smaller brands just to have access to their designs and their teams. So I remember I brought up Fisker as an example because he was a designer, I want to say at BMW, and where I could see someone wanting to acquire his brand just to make him stay on for a couple of years for designs and have that brand take off. But then, you know, it seems like there's countless of these stocks out there now to where a lot of them will be going under. And maybe some of the more premium ones with like big name backers. I remember like Leonardo DiCaprio and some other celebrities were a backer of one of them. So I could see that being a brand that it actually gets acquired just for like the star power behind it. But I think a lot of these smaller players just need to disappear entirely. And I kind of just think back to an interview that Elon Musk did where he was, they were saying, you know, if you have any advice for someone entering the car business, what would it be? And he says, don't do it. Like, it's just an absolutely terrible idea. It's grueling. And chances are you're going to fail. And Tesla came within days of failing before. And that's when he was like sleeping on the production floor and all that, just not looking all that healthy. And he made it through. But I don't think any of these other companies really have an Elon Musk running the show, that they either need to cut some deals soon to get taken out. Now, Lucid's an outlier because they'll always have the Saudis as the big backers. So I could see them just being taken over entirely. But a lot of these other ones, they either need to buddy up with a bigger automaker or figure something out to reduce expenses now and elongate their runways.
Let's literally and metaphorically take flight real quick, because I know you wanted to touch on Joby. I was just taking a look, up 85% this last month. I know, Joe, you kind of hate the eVTOL space just because it's, you know, they really are kind of a coin flip. Shit's not happening. But some interesting news here. Joby received a nod from the FAA to begin testing their electric air taxis. So touch on that, Shai.
Yeah, Joby is currently at the stage 4 of the FAA certification process. I mean, we're still in the early innings in the eVTOL space. I know the projections are it's going to hit $1 trillion by 2040. So this is a multi-decade play. It's still very early innings. It's definitely had a run-up this week. It was a pretty short stock, but they have some great partnerships in Uber, Delta Airlines, and Toyota. So I'd wait for it to cool off a little, but it's definitely a great long-term play if you want to be in the space.
Yeah, it's going to be heavily regulated, I can only imagine. And that never is quick with the government. So, and God forbid one crashes, that's going to delay it another 5 years probably as well. But other flight news, United Airlines CEO blames the FAA for numerous cancellations, probably because they're testing all these Joby flights and it's fucking with the United Airlines. Jump in.
Listen, so I mean, my whole thing on this space is now my kids will try to make fun of me saying I'm afraid of heights. I'm not afraid of heights. I'm not a fan of heights. So if you're telling me, hey, Joey, take a car that's going to be 30 minutes or take a helicopter that's going to be 6 minutes, like, no, thank you. Just the thought of taking a helicopter somewhere where I can just pop in an Uber. And that's where, like, every time someone's bringing up these eVTOLs, oh, Joey, what do you think about Joby? And there's another Lilium and E-Hang, all these helicopter
service. For a bit.
I'm just defaulting to, you know, Uber has Ubercopter. I think it's still in operation to where you want like some sort of future of transportation. Why go to one of these other ones that are trying to have these fancy flying car type things? It's only the best in class that is becoming a free cash flow machine in Uber and call it a day.
I wonder if the submarine news had any effect. It looks like it did not.
I want to say Uber actually had some sort of like submarine type service in Australia. That they might have been like just testing it. Introducing Scuba. Yeah. The world's first ride-share submarine, May 23rd, 2019. And this is from Uber itself, so it's not fake. Yeah. Introducing Scuba, the world's first ride-share submarine on the Great Barrier Reef. I don't know if that's still in operation, but like, again, anything that has to move with moving a person from point A to point B, Uber is involved.
If any Uber executives are listening, they could also pivot into Poober, toilets on demand, where you could have the toilet come to you.
That was actually a skit on Comedy Central once, I want to say. Like, you pull up.
Expecting more laughs.
Yeah, basically, like, instead of a public bathroom, you find it on the app and you stop at someone's house and yeah, use it. But yeah, also, I think the name Scuba is incredible to where I'll do some research so we can tweet out to people to see
it. Or Rick's could upgrade Boober. And have Ubers drive them directly to Rick's if they're listening.
Man, that was our idea.
Let's get into some AI news. Y Combinator said their latest batch of startups, 35% of the money is moving into AI. So we've touched on this the past few weeks. There's a lot of money flowing in there. And I think it's interesting investment from a VC or an accelerator standpoint where they may not need to throw, you know, 10 million, 15, 20 million at these early stage companies to grow out. With AI, you know, again, we've talked about this, small five, you know, two-person companies can start to take off. NVIDIA in the U.S. is planning AI chip export controls. Snowflake and NVIDIA, they partnered to help businesses harness their data. Snowflake's also partnered with Microsoft to expand the AI product offerings, increase investment in Azure. And then Microsoft finally has new AI-powered tools in Bing and Edge platforms. I don't want to keep pounding the table on AI because we've talked about it quite a bit, but anything notable here?
Well, I mean, Snowflake is a data company, so it's interesting to see they put out headlines that they're helping companies harness their data. It's like, yeah, that's what you do. My question for you is, what does Snowflake call their employees? Are they snowflakes?
Ba-dum-ching. That was good. Not a
hopeless question. I'm Googling.
God, did you laugh more at his or my joke earlier? We got to take a this poll here. IBM is acquiring technology spend management platform Apptio for $4.6 billion. Apple, other big news, planning a new Apple Watch Ultra alongside the new iPhone 15 this fall. Google is testing a new YouTube product offering called Playables for its online gaming platform as well. Amazon is launching their local business delivery network to enable small businesses to manage their own deliveries. What does that mean? I had to look it up. But basically, I think Kohl's did this and other areas where people could come drop it off. Similarly, for small business now, effectively, they're going to, instead of going to a radius of 10 miles, they can now drop it off at a small business, pay that small business to actually do that last mile of delivery. So that's a pretty innovative approach.
Well, my question for that would be, does the small business that's partnering with Amazon have to be involved in logistics? Or are they just finding like, say one business at the base of like some massive building and then they're distributing to the rest of them? Because I would almost look at this as a lot of work for Amazon to find the right partners in those areas. Now, if it's a small logistics firm, that'd be another thing. But like, what if, you know, like two companies that are competitors are in the same building, you're dropping off to one because they're the drop point, and then they just start, you know, messing with their competitor, not getting them their packages. Or well, like, I always think of like, and what if you did that in a neighborhood where like you drop it at the guard gate or your designated neighbor to deliver your packages, but then you get like nosy Nancy that wants to, you know, be up in everybody's business. Why not just find more small businesses to partner with on the logistics front? Or, you know, I haven't even looked into how much is it to like own some routes on for Amazon and, you know, like operate that type of business, just because I thought it'd be interesting to kind of look into. And I feel like that would be more beneficial for them to more people, or even like their existing drivers, you know, talk them into starting their own businesses to take over some more areas. But maybe this is a short-term solution, and then long-term, it's just about beefing up their logistics unit.
This will be one to monitor. You brought up a good point too. Like, what if they're late and this Amazon Prime Now is not the 2-day and that kind of messes up their whole branding? It may have more of a negative effect, but thinking this through a little more than we have here. So
just get back to focusing on where I'm going to have the little helipad in my backyard or front porch where the drone's going to deliver my stuff.
You'd rather have that?
I feel like it's something that I could, like, more feasible long term. Like, when you think of, like, the future of delivery, yeah, you could have some, like, drone dropping a package. Now, of course, it's got to be some sort of elevated platform, because last thing you want are some kids to be get hit by drones. Or, I mean, Trevor Bauer can't even catch a drone. Why would, like, some other adult try to catch one and, you know, chop a finger off? I feel like there's a lot of room for error in there. But then it's almost like everybody has a mailbox out front. Now you got to have a little drone helipad in the backyard. It's going to take some adoption, but, you know, we talk about some weird stuff. So why not talk about the drone and the helipads?
Facebook, or Meta, as they now are known by, launching a VR subscription for $7.99 a month, up 2.3% today, up 8.8% on the month. Kind of a choppy week, to say the least, but this is interesting. Have they done subscriptions, or am I completely off base?
Everything I've seen to this point is, like, you buy their headset and then you buy, you know, whatever you're going to be operating on. Now, what would be cool is if they took it one step further, instead of selling, like, the Quest for one set price and then having a subscription, have one that includes the Quest, kind of like when you're buying a phone. Like, okay, you could buy the phone, the service, or you want to buy both at the same time, but still pay a monthly. Now, it's kind of like an Affirm type version, but almost like, yeah, $40 a month, we'll give you the headset and access to different things. I could see that could be eventually what they're going to do, but need more adoption to kind of get to that point.
I was talking to my buddy about that. Imagine if they went the Roku route, where you lost money on the hardware, but just, like, they got the scaling right and just made the money on the subscriptions every single month, and just everyone would have their headset and they'd rake in that subscription dollar amount, high gross margins. Like, that'd be pretty wild. And I think kind of squash the Apple ProQuest battle.
Yeah. I've been bullish Meta. I know it's a pretty hated stock because I feel like people just dislike Zuck, but, you know, you can't cuck the Zuck, as we always say. Coming back to you, Shai, U.S. Supreme Court made a ruling here that has affected SoFi. So the U.S. Supreme Court rejected the first two challenges of President Biden's student debt forgiveness plan. How does this affect SoFi?
So I think a lot of this news was already priced in. As you guys know, like, SoFi has been on a tear this past month. But I'm happy with the decision by the SCOTUS. I mean, the president's proposed plan wasn't really tackling the issue. It doesn't solve the root cause, doesn't eliminate the long-term debt. It doesn't hold the wealthy universities accountable. So I'm glad Congress and the folks in Washington finally, like, worked and solved the root of the, they're going to start working and solving this root, and so just, like, accepting the president's proposal. So that's bullish on the economy, but
see, that was fake in itself. Biden knew from the start that in no way are we just gonna, you know, make debt disappear on behalf of the U.S. government.
Like, it has to come from somewhere.
It was a way to get votes. And when it gets struck down, because it's like, dude, you can't do that, it's gonna be, oh, it's the Republicans' fault. They voted this down. I can't make your debt magically disappear. It's like, dude, we have $32 trillion in debt, and you're going to go forgiving debt that people took on willingly, you know, to get jobs in your great economy. But now they can't get those great jobs because wages aren't growing and there really aren't that many job openings because the JOLTS data is fake. Like, come on, man. It took me 10 years to graduate college because I paid for a class at a time. Plus, you know, I dropped out a time or two. But, like, I took one class at a time. It was like $1,500 per class, something ridiculous. And it's because I knew debt is toxic. I never want to deal with that. I don't want to be the person paying back loans. So I was like, I'll just take a class at a time, slowly save up, pay for a class, save up, pay for a class. Like, I took on a mortgage. I know I have to pay that back. If you take something on, hey, take responsibility. You're an adult now. Pay it back. If you want some handouts, more power to you. But it's like, we can't try to make debt magically disappear because that's not how it works. It has to go somewhere. And what it's going to do, it's going to go back to everybody else. And it's like, I have enough responsibilities in my life. I don't want to be paying other people's debt through tax increases and other things. So yeah, it goes back to that entire proposal was fake. It was a way to try to buy some votes. And he knew it would backfire, but now he's got people to blame. And it's like, okay, now what ridiculous thing are we going to, you know, some fake proposal to buy some more votes?
Politics as usual, as Jay-Z says. So Joey, considering now all of these people have to pay that back, like what's the direct impact to SoFi? Like, is that all of a sudden, is that why we've seen this run up now? Because all these people are going to start to use them more because they don't have money?
I think a lot of the run up was in anticipation of this because, you know, at some point the loan repayment has to resume. And SoFi is a big player in that space. Another one you could look at is like Nelnet, which Shai and I were talking about earlier, is like a major player in that space. But it's good for SoFi that people are going to be getting back into doing this. They'll be making money on that front. And if you want more information on that, I think Brad Freeman is a very good resource at Stock Market Nerd on Twitter. I've seen plenty of posts where he like explains the ins and outs of this. I think Shai, you've actually been tweeting about this as well. I want to say you did something on SoFi, but there's a lot of great people on Twitter that kind of explain it much deeper than I would. I'm one of those where I love SoFi as a product and service. Like I think I have like my SEP IRA there. And I might have some other accounts, sorry, like tracking my credit score and some other stuff there. So I think it's a great product and service. But what it comes back to for me is like, it's a bank stock to where, you know, it's not something that I'm all that interested in. Yeah, they've got some great growth metrics on their side. It's a great product and service, but it's not something that I see as like, I really want to own this stock. And especially something boring like student loans or something like that. It could be like one of those steady Eddie if I want exposure to that side of the financials thing. But I feel like, you know, as close as I want to get to financials is PayPal, because it's more of something like that I understand. I kind of see the long-term growth trajectory and it's not stuck just in banking, but it's got these other growth avenues like, you know, B2B payments and B2C. Plus Venmo is, you know, Venmo is like, no one uses Cash App. I don't know where all those users come from, or unless it's like my entire friend base, or maybe it's a West Coast thing, but like nobody that I know uses Cash App. It's all Venmo. Venmo is life for a lot of us. So, I mean, if you use Cash App, tweet me and tell me I'm wrong.
So they're going to be able to show, I imagine, millions of new customers coming on board. Are these good customers though? If they're already in debt, maybe that's good for what their business model is. However, if they have a ton of people now defaulting on these loans, that could affect them, or if they have to go out and raise a bunch of cash to satisfy those loans as well.
Well, the cool thing about SoFi is they even say on their website, they're geared towards helping their members get money right. So they have a lot of good educational tools on like, hey, if you're in debt, this is how you get out of it. This is why you want to be out of it. And then they've got all these tools to kind of set you on the right path. If you have student loans, I feel like they're a good provider to where you can at least, you know, figure out how to get where you want to be. But in the end, yeah, you took on some loans. So at some point, just be prepared to pay those back.
I foresee a lot of refinancing. I think that's where SoFi is going to make a lot more money on this moratorium ending. But like just what Joey said earlier, like how do you value SoFi? I love the business. I love like what they're doing, their message, trying to educate everyone on how to handle their money. But do you value them as a bank or a tech company? Like, I think there's a weird middle ground happening right now. And like the battle of that valuation is it a bank or tech? And I think that's where I sold SoFi this week just because I started questioning my original thesis on like why I own it. And I think it's best to sit on the sidelines until you are fully confident in the actual company you're investing in. So I'm going to wait till the earnings report in the next couple months. Reevaluate if I do want to get it or not. But I do think the announcement today was priced in and isn't going to be that effective in the SoFi's actual like revenue for the next couple quarters.
Jerry, I see you wanted to talk about overstock.com. They've been quote unquote raging in the words of Joey Rockets.
How does it work? Like I know they bought it for $21 million, but it just skyrocketed fivefold or instantly like after that. Like it doesn't make sense to me.
So looking at overstock.com, OSTK, they're up 70% year to date, including 33% this week and 70% in the last month. So I saw they acquired the branding for Bed Bath & Beyond. It's like all their digital operations. So then overstock.com announced they'll be changing its name to Bed Bath & Beyond. So essentially that is, it's like merging the two operations and that's all that they're going to be doing. Now, I get that that's good for Overstock because it's more of a recognizable name, but it's like you're changing your name to a failed retailer. And like, that's why are you going to do this better than they did? Now, maybe Bed Bath & Beyond, because like their stores, I mean, they had stores everywhere. And I lived by two before. And I swear, every time I shopped in there, I was like one of three people. No one was ever in there. So maybe, yeah, the online part is the only valuable asset. But I still want to know about Bye Bye Baby. Like, what's happening with that brand? Because that's actually a great brand, high quality products. Those stores were always packed. Maybe that's changed. You know, I haven't been to that store in a while. It's kind of like all things Amazon and Target to get all the baby stuff. But yeah, it's very interesting to see that they're running so hard on this deal and like the name change. Then is this overdone or am I completely missing something? So I'll be doing some more homework on that to see if there's any possibility. But again, I kind of don't want to say the answer before, but you know, I had no interest in this for a reason. You know, Amazon's one of my largest positions. I've had Etsy and PayPal, a lot of better ways to play e-commerce and the growth in that space that I don't think I'll ever slum it with an Overstock, just like I wouldn't slum it with a Bed Bath & Beyond. Mm-hmm. But I like to stay informed. So I kind of want to see, why is this rallying so hard? And like, is there some other conclusion to be drawn?
Yeah, I don't want to chase a stock ever either. It's been
never
over the past month, as you said. Like, you're not big on options, but maybe shy. Is this an area where you throw some puts on this, thinking that it's just ran up too much and kind of overbought right now?
I got to see the IV on the option chain, but I mean, I would. I think, to be honest, I think a lot of the consumer brands are going to suffer next rest of the year with this student loan payments have like reintroduced to the consumers. Like, there's going to be a lot of people who are going to commit $500 to like $1,500 a month away from their pockets that they were using to spend on products. So, like you said, Overstock is definitely overbought. It's over, the RSI is over 70. The daily and weekly chart looks overextended. So I wouldn't be surprised if a short-term dip and sell the news type of events, but I would not be confident in the space at all.
Yeah, I know you're a big fitness guy and you want to talk about Exponential Fitness, which is a stock that I've never heard about, but XPOF, is that Chamath's SPAC then?
No. So Exponential Fitness, they came public through a traditional IPO. It's one that my friend Jonah and I have talked about for a long time. I remember looking at this at like $9 shortly after the IPO because my wife does Pure Bar and that's one of the brands that they own. And it, you know, it's one of those franchisors of these, they have a lot of brands. So one thing you might know are like Pure Bar, Row House, Club Pilates, and Yoga 6 is expanding pretty quick. So, I mean, they've got these franchises all over the place. The stock had been on a tear since its IPO. I want to say like tripled, maybe almost quadrupled. But the short report comes out questioning, you know, how well franchisees are really doing. And then focusing a lot on leadership about, you know, talking about like a shady background that included boiler rooms and all this. Now, of course, kind of got to take short reports with a grain of salt because they will make things seem more extreme so they get the result they want, which is a tanking stock. And Exponential Fitness and even like people that cover the stock came out and said a lot of that was misleading. But I mean, the short report did what it set out to do and it was down as much as 42% on the day of the release. It might have been a little bit worse, but that's as deep as I saw it get. And it's still hovering around 17 and change. From a high of 33. So yeah, it's taken a beating. Now I got to do some more research on like the current valuation growth rates because it's one of those where once the market changed, it's not something like I'm not going to mess with a small cap fitness stock or like Planet Fitness. I've always liked that, but it's not something that's great in this market. Not something I'm going to be focusing on. I wanted to like, you know, the flight to safety of the Amazon, Google, Meta, Tesla type things, even though you could say that those aren't the ultimate safety stocks, but some that I trusted more parking cash in. But yeah, it is. I mean, the first thing is like the short report by Fuzzy Panda Research. So as soon as I see those guys, I'm like, okay, is this a serious short firm or like what? Like I think I've heard the name before, but looking into the, like their previous shorts, I'm like, okay, so they've been doing this for a while. Looking into the report, I'm like, okay, some of these things seem a little bit extreme. Let's see if there's some sort of truth to it. So I do want to do some fact checking on like the CEO, his background, you know, anything about his past that could be, you know, worrisome. But I look at the brands and, you know, within like 2 miles of my house, there's Pure Bar, two Club Pilates, there's a Yoga 6 right across the streets. I mean, these brands are all over the place. So I don't know if I want to like talk to some of the franchisees to see how well they're doing, but I mean, these brands keep popping up. So something's got to give, at least on that front.
You got to do your own research. Like I did at the Korean barbecue spot, was empty at lunchtime. That was one you were talking about, though, Joe.
Oh, yeah. So we might as well talk about that one since it just went public. The stock ticker is GENK. It's a Gen Restaurant Group, and it's basically a Korean barbecue joint. And when I was looking at the S1, it's like the average unit volume was way up there for just 34 company-owned locations. So yeah, I once I saw there was one in New York City, I was like, Avi, you got to check this out and see if it's legit. And yeah, you went at lunch. You're like the only
person. I was the only one in there. And I was like, is this open? And she's like, yeah. But she did say they're open to like 2 a.m. They have like a 4 a.m. crowd. So I think it's not as much of a lunch area. But I was surprised. It was on 3rd and 14th, I want to say. So it's like a very busy area. So I was surprised. As I was leaving, there was a few other folks trickling in. The food was good, though. I will say the food was pretty solid. Spicy chicken was exceptional.
And what I found cool is like this could be something where, you know, it reminded me of Kura Sushi, which actually reports earnings next week, where it's like one of those different type. It's a differentiated brand to where, you know, it could have some sort of uptake if, you know, they keep looking to expand it. And you're looking at the unit volume, it is over $2 million to where like, okay, this is significant. They do some business. And then doing a little bit more digging, guests cook most of the food themselves. So they're like order, bring it to the table and you're like cooking it. So that reduces the need for chefs and servers. And so like, okay, this could actually be something that, you know, helps margins in the long term. It's like a great experience, good margins. They could, you know, have some sort of staying power and expansion potential. But yeah, your experience of not seeing many people while you're there wasn't all that great. But to hear that it was more of a night spot. So I guess the next thing, send you out at, you know, midnight for a midnight Korean
bar. Expense these deals, by the way. This is bullshit.
Yeah, this is directly research. So I feel like we'll do some research and see, hey, this is strictly for research. You're not going there because you want Korean barbecue. You want to research the stock.
We got another Pounder's thesis in just a second. So stay tuned. But real quick, I want to just touch on China. Shein files for a US-based IPO offering. That's a company I've heard of. Chinese company always has flags to it, but this one you're going to look into a little bit more or not touching?
I thought it was called Shine.
I actually just Googled it, how to pronounce, so I didn't sound like an idiot. It is pronounced Shein, according to Shein Official's Twitter.
Interesting. Oh, yeah. It says it right here on Twitter. Exactly. This is how it's pronounced Shein. Cool.
Yeah.
All right. Well,
with that being said, does that change now you're super into it? I kind of like the name. Shein.
I mean, so it comes back to it's a fashion retailer, and I consider myself, you know, very far from a fashionista. So, you know, anything like that, tons of inventory closed. I mean, the consumer habits change so fast. I mean, it goes from, you know, one thing to the next so fast. Like Michael Kors was all the rage, and then out of nowhere, no one's wearing their watches or purses. And, you know, Coach was all the rage, then it wasn't. So I don't know about like, you know, blouses and stuff, like if that has more staying power. But when I look at it, it doesn't excite me. And if you're saying it's based in China, that double does not excite me. So yeah, I'd have to pass on this one, and probably one that I don't even waste my time. That's a lie. I look in all S1s and F1s just because I'm an addict. But yeah, I will be interested to buy this one. I mean, on the retail front, the only thing that I found interesting of late was Savers Value Village. It's like the largest operator of secondhand stores in the United States. And there's a Savers Value Village like 20 minutes away. Once I was like Googling, I was like, oh yeah, it's like right next to an Aldi. There's one of those. And then there's a Second Ave, one of their other banners. So it's like, I want to go check those out. The thing is, it's like thrift stores, like the average ticket isn't going to be all that big. So it's like, you got to have a lot of people coming through and you got to be in the right areas. Then I look at like all the problems at dollar stores and all the discount companies. Mm-hmm. It seems like, you know, the way to go with retail or branding is always like the super luxury, like the Louis Vuitton type area, rather than aiming at stores that would be aimed at the middle or lower classes, to where those are interesting. The financials look cool. Look good, but it's like anytime you're ever looking at retail, if you want some sort of staying power, like steady gains, you've got to look at the luxury space and really can't go any other way.
I mean, I totally agree. I think one of the worst sectors in the marketplace is the online retail and fashion companies. I mean, if you look at a couple companies that went public, like RealReal, Stitch Fix, Farfetch, Poshmark, they are all down over 90% since they went public.
Hey, Poshmark got acquired at least. At least they found a buyer for that. But yeah, RealReal, I remember right after that IPO company I was at, there's some people like researching the stock and there's a report coming out that like their authentication process wasn't all that great to where a bunch of fakes were getting through. I remember sending a message saying, oh, check it out, RealReal's fake, and got zero replies on that. And so like, I mean, I didn't make a lot of friends at a lot of the company I was at. I mean, that's why I never really lasted all that long. But like, I found that to be very worrisome. Like you call yourself RealReal, you have some fakes getting through. And some of these other Stitch Fix was, that was just the ultimate turd that I want to see. The old Joey Rockets Twitter account, every time that would come up, I'd put the gif of like the Jurassic Park, the guy's taking his glasses off and it's a big pile of steaming poop. And I feel like that is the most accurate representation of that stock and everything that it has going for it. I'm going to see if I can pull one of those and retweet it. But I think all those are dead now. And yeah. Passes the
right. Well, Shai, we brought you back, man. It is the moment I think everyone's waiting for of the podcast now, the Pounders thesis. So again, last week you had Unity. This is in no way investment advice, but it's just fun to bring people on, have them share about a company that they're interested in. We'll always do a bear case and a bull case. Always do your own research. That all said though, Shai, talk to me about UiPath. What do they do? But just give me an overview as to what they do. And of course, like why you like them. And then also please share a bear case too.
I think it's our responsibility kind of decipher the actual generative AI plays in the marketplace. Every company is saying they have some kind of AI angle and it's a moat for their company, but I'll believe it once I see the numbers. And UiPath is definitely an AI play. They create robots, but they're software robots. And what they do is they automate routine tasks that humans are usually doing, but humans don't have to. So if you're even doing a repetitive task over and over again, you can use UiPath to automate that task for you. So they can see what's on the screen. They can think about what needs to be done and they can fill it in for you. And you might ask, how are they doing? Well, they have an annual recurring revenue of over $1.3 billion and has grown over 28% since last year. They've got around 11,000 customers globally. And I also want to call out that their dollar-based net retention rate is 127%. So that 127% means that not only are they holding on to those 11,000 customers, but on average, they're spending 27% more with UiPath every year. That's incredible. That tells you everything you need to know about, do the customers like the product and do they appreciate the technology? The answer is yes. The company also reported a substantial increase in large customers with an annual recurring revenue that exceeded $1 million, growing by 43%. And with a market cap of just under $10 billion, and they're aiming to do $1.3 billion rev this year, that's around a 7x price to sales ratio, which is very underutilized in the space. They're also maintaining a 12% free cash flow margin and a 15% net income margin. I think the valuation is definitely underappreciated, especially if you see some other competitors in this space. If you want to talk some bear cases, I think some bear cases that come to mind is the deceleration in growth rate and the dampening effect of the dollar's value on the company's international sales. A lot of their business is across the Atlantic Ocean, so the dollar is affecting them a lot. So that's why they offered a couple metrics during their earnings report of what it would be like if they exclude FX. Another bear case would be they have a lot of on-premise customers that are going to need to migrate to the cloud because over the long term, it is more expensive to service those on-premise customers. So it's going to be harder for them to upsell them. So when a company makes that transition, they need to handle it correctly to make sure they don't lose those customers. But investors also need to know this will, over the short term, cause revenue to go down. Something that one of my positions in my portfolio Atlassian is experiencing at the moment, but in the long run, it's going to make the product stickier. So it's worth that transition, but it's something to keep your eye on.
When did they move to the US? I was just looking, they're founded in Romania. Now they're headquartered here in New York. So when you were saying that a lot of their business today is overseas, I actually kind of looked at that as a potential upside. If they're just entering the market over the past couple of years, they have to build a name for themselves. The stock overall, if you're just looking at price action, right? They opened up around 74, 75, I think, at the time of the IPO here. And they've come down significantly. The price right now is 1672. Joey, I'd love to hear your thoughts too, if you've looked into this at all.
So I loved UiPath even at like the time of the IPO. I just think it came out so hot. It priced like 56. I want to say it was over $100 at some point. It was way up there. It was just like the right time to IPO for a name like this. You know, it's been an interesting one. So this is right there with Unity when I was looking at like, okay, what are all like the AI plays that people are overlooking in this market as AI started taking off? But then things just like absolutely took off to where now everything's kind of left in the dust.
I was just going to say another bear case is they have 13 C-suite members. That is way too many people paying that much for. There's definitely duplicate work happening in the executive level. And when you see the number 13, I'm like, okay, they're not really meeting efficient corporate governance potentially. So that's another bear case.
Could be an upside though. They fire these guys pretty quickly. That's a huge expense. Yeah, you know, executives get paid quite a bit. So potentially there as well. All right, Joey, wrap us up with the earnings. It's 4th of July weekend. So I don't know if this is the... Probably next week, we'll do like a little 4th of July special since I know we didn't touch on that at all. But anything big on earnings? I didn't see any major names, but...
So for next week, yeah, very small. You got... So Monday, you have F45 on here and you didn't realize they were public. I did. I remember when this happened because it's a big fitness chain. It's kind of...
They're cross-training, right?
You what?
They're franchise-based?
Yeah. Yeah. So they've got a bunch. They've got a bunch around me and... I remember first hearing about it well before the IPO because Mark Wahlberg was a big back rub. I don't know if he owned a bunch of franchises. And I saw another headline, like once the CEO stepped down, that he was taking more of a role with the company. So I don't know what exactly he's doing there, but that's interesting. I don't know if I would ever want to touch the stock. It falls in the same category as like Exponential Fitness and Planet Fitness to where it's just not the right stock right now. And then Thursday, we've got Kura Sushi, KRUS, which has been... This is the company that reminded me of like Gen Barbecue when it was coming public. I'm like, this could be one of those like just under the radar restaurant plays that have staying power and long-term potential because of differentiation. And then good old Levi's on Thursday because nothing's more exciting than denim.
What happens historically headed into 4th of July? Like on the short week here we got coming up. Is there any historical data on how the markets perform around 4th of July?
Nothing all that significant that I've caught wind of.
Yeah, I mean, Monday is a shortened trading day. So I don't know what happens usually on like days where there's only less than 5 hours.
How terrible is that? First, we go from, you go weekends, you get a close of 1 p.m., then it's closed on Tuesday. Like, that's terrible. I hate shortened trading weeks, let alone like a double shortened.
So historically, the volume's typically lower. Obviously, we just touched on it. Monday is going to be a shortened day of trading. What'd you say? Tuesday, Wednesday? Tuesday's 4th of July.
Then yes, Tuesday is according to Monday closes at 1.
Okay. So very short week. In fact, go out and trade. Go. Sorry, 3, 2, 1. So with that short week, enjoy your 4th of July's. We'll be back next week, of course. But take the week off of trading. Just go enjoy your time with your family and friends. So. Any last words, either of you guys, that you want to leave our listeners pondering over the week?
Make good choices.
That's a big move.
And it's simple. Big money, love big it. Moves. We'll be back next That's week, folks.
Yeah. Make a play, don't talk about it. Master P, I'm about it. This one here for all that try to count me out and they still counting. Honestly, I never doubt it. Say the top is never crowded. Well, I'm trying to climb the mountain till I need a few accountants. Stock is rising, perfect timing. I'm in prickle with the tribe. Shawty sliding, she want sushi, she want eel sauce with the rice. I just